The hearing of the Subcommittee on Tactical Air and Land Forces will come to order on ground and rotorcraft force modernization programs. The subcommittee meets to receive testimony on the Army and Marine Corps modernization requests for fiscal year 2015. I want to welcome our witnesses, Lieutenant General James Barkley, Deputy Chief of Staff of the Army G8, Major General Michael Williamson, Military Deputy to the Assistant Secretary of the Army, Acquisition, Logistics, and Technology, Mr. Tom D., Deputy Assistant Secretary of the Navy, Expeditionary Programs and Logistic Management, and Lieutenant General Glenn Walters, United States Marine Corps Deputy Commandant for Programs and Resources. General Barkley, it's nice to see you again. General Williamson, congratulations on your new position. I understand you will be pinning on your third star in just a couple of days. Thank you all for your service, and we look forward to your testimony. Today, we will cover a broad portfolio of modernization programs to include ground combat systems, tactical vehicles, rotorcraft, and individual gear such as body armor. Based on this current fiscal environment, the military services are having to accept greater risk in modernization programs in the near term. That is the new fiscal reality. Programs that were top priorities a year ago are now being terminated or delayed, and modernization portfolios are being significantly restructured. This hearing will provide an opportunity for our witnesses to inform us as of the many challenges they are facing in acquisition and industrial base management. We all know that when the military goes into harm's way, that they fight in a joint environment. In other words, the full power of all of the services come together in order to accomplish our national security objectives. What is less understood, especially outside the jurisdictions of the defense committees, is how the services depend on each other from an industrial base perspective, especially for ground, rotorcraft, and individual equipment platforms such as body armor. For example, decisions that the Army makes about Abrams tanks or Stryker combat vehicles could affect the Marine Corps ACV program. Decisions the Navy makes about Black Hawk helicopters could affect how the Army is procuring helicopters. All the military services are dependent upon the same body armor and tactical wheeled vehicle industrial bases. The point I'm making is that certainly Congress takes criticism for the perceived parochial support of one platform over another. But the reality is, although we certainly support American jobs in our districts, the bigger picture of concern and oversight isn't about the survival of one platform versus another. It's about what capabilities does an Army Brigade combat team or Marine Expeditionary Brigade need in order to meet the needs of our commandant commanders so that they can meet our national security requirements. It is within that context, once we understand the threats and required capabilities, that we then must understand what industrial-based capability is needed now and in the future in order to provide the right capability to our military at the right time. I want to highlight this point about our defense industrial base because I believe there is a general misunderstanding outside of those who serve our defense committees. This industrial base cannot be turned on and off like a light switch. And it is the purview of this committee and our subcommittee's responsibilities to look into the industrial base and find ways that we need to preserve the industrial base for the service of all of our service branches. We all understand that sequestration is still the law, but my concern is that if we don't like what is reflected in this year's budget request, we're certainly going to be facing even more difficulty in the upcoming year. This is part of our challenge and part of our discussion today and the questions that we'll be having of this panel. I want to thank each of you for being here and for your expertise as we look to the issues of not only what do each of the service branches need, what is the industrial base that supports them, and what is the interconnectivity of that industrial base and how it needs to be preserved. With that, I turn to Ms. Sanchez for her remarks.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman, and thank you, everybody, for being here today. Today's hearing, of course, will cover our Army and Marine Corps ground system modernization programs. And this broad range of topics covering everything from individual equipment, such as body armor, Abrams tanks, Stryker vehicles. However, in looking at the fiscal year 2015 budget, I do see some general trends, many of them which are troubling to me. First, it's clear that the modernization of the Army and the Marine Corps ground equipment is under serious budget pressure. And it looks to me as if these accounts are becoming the bill payer for both services' overall budget shortfalls. With only a few exceptions, almost every major program in this area has been scaled back, delayed, or terminated, in a large part, I believe, because of a lack of funding. For example, the Army is terminating the Ground Combat Vehicle Program, delaying its high-priority tactical network programs, dramatically scaling back wheeled vehicle upgrades, and slowing down production of Apache attack helicopters. The Marines. Purchases of new joint light tactical vehicles are delayed. The amphibious combat vehicle program is being scaled back. And I don't see a lot of new investment in most areas. And the second trend that I see is both services' ability to actually field new systems through the normal acquisition process. In the area of large-scale acquisition Category 1 programs, we continue to start things with a big fanfare, and then we end up terminating because of cost growth, because of changing priorities, because of shifting service requirements, and in addition, constantly changing senior service leadership priorities appear to be making it very difficult for the respective service acquisition officials to keep programs funded in the budget long enough to actually see these new capabilities in the field. As a result, both the Army and the Marine Corps keep funding new programs, but don't seem to get those programs across the finish line. And you know the examples. In the Army, the termination of the Ground Combat Vehicle is the most recent example, where we spent more than $1 billion and we have nothing to show for it. The Marine Corps has spent more than $3 billion over 20 years trying to field a vehicle to replace the current amphibious assault vehicle, but we still haven't gotten anything new for our Marines. The third trend I see is this which is disturbing, is the needless duplication between the Army and Marine Corps equipment. To name a few, both the Marine Corps and the Army are working on separate multi-mission radar systems, separate precision mortar rounds, and separate 120-millimeter tank ammunition. The Army and the Marine Corps also don't use the same helicopters, despite obvious similarities between the missions that they conduct with these helicopter fleets. One example is the fact that the Army, the Air Force, and the Navy all use UH-60 Black Hawk helicopters of various models, but the Marine Corps continues to request hundreds of millions for upgrades to its aging fleet of H-1 helicopters. And in some cases, I'm sure that duplication or differences in equipment are appropriate and necessary, but I think that there may be a way in which, if we're really looking for monies, we should work more closely together on that. I don't want to end on a sour note, because I'm certainly a pretty big optimist, so I'll just say that there are some areas where I've seen success. Body armor, as you know, has been a big priority in looking at and being on this committee. So in the area of body armor and protective equipment, both the Army and the Marine Corps now have well-established research and development efforts and a healthy inventory of high-quality equipment. But I remain concerned of the ability for the services to maintain those investments in protective equipment. Both services have also done a good job while keeping the Joint Light Tactical Vehicle Program on track. It's a model of how competition and stable requirements and thorough testing can lead to successful acquisition programs. So, I know I'm going to have some questions, because these trends for me are a little alarming, but I look forward to today's hearing. Thank you, Mr. Chairman.
Thank you. We'll turn to General Barkley, who will then be followed by Mr. D and General Walters. General Barkley.
Sir, Chairman Turner, Congressman Sanchez, distinguished members of the subcommittee, I'd like to thank you for the opportunity to discuss the Army's fiscal year 2015 President's budget request as it pertains to the Army Modernization Program. And on behalf of our Secretary, the Honorable John McHugh, and our Chief of Staff, General Ray Odierno, Major General Williamson, and myself look forward to discussing the Army's FY15 modernization budget. Over the past 3 years, the Army has absorbed several budgetary reductions in the midst of conducting operations overseas and rebalancing the force for a wider array of missions called for by the President's defense strategy. And during this period of fiscal and strategic uncertainty, our goal has been to maintain the proper balance between in strength, readiness, and modernization across the total Army. We're reducing our end strength as rapidly and as responsibly as possible, while at the same time doing our best to meet our operational requirements. Additionally, we need to concentrate funds on rebuilding readiness at the same time. However, to do this, we must accept greater risk in our modernization programs in the near term. And as a result of this, the research, development, and acquisition investments have declined 37% since the FY12 budget planning cycle. Historically, the Army's RDA account has averaged about 22% of its obligation authority. And for FY15, the RDA account is at 17%, or about $20 billion of obligation authority. And regardless of the austere physical conditions, it remains the Army's responsibility to ensure every soldier deployed is equipped to achieve decisive overmatch. And to do this, the Army has developed several initiatives that guide equipment modernization. We are using incremental improvements to modernize our critical systems, and we will build new systems only by exception. We are divesting older systems and niche capabilities to decrease the sustainment cost and generate additional resources that we can invest in our modernization and readiness posture. We're also procuring smaller quantities because the Army cannot afford to equip and sustain the entire force with the most advanced equipment. And we are focusing our science and technology investments where we are technology makers and reducing S&T where we are the technology takers. These guiding principles ensures the Army will maximize every dollar towards putting the best equipment in the hands of our soldiers. First and foremost, the soldier and the squad is the centerpiece of Army equipment modernization, from which we build outward by enabling them with the network and key equipment. And within this year's budget request, we seek to empower and unburden the soldier through funding for enhanced weapon capabilities, next generation optics and night vision devices, and advanced body armor and individual protection equipment. We will modernize the network to improve soldiers' decision-making with information and connectivity down to the lowest tactical level. Our priorities include the Warfighter Information Network Tactical Systems, the family of network radios, and the Joint Battle Command Platform. Investments in the network, however, are not untouched by resource constraints, and as a result, we will delay a portion of our WIN-T Increment 3 and reduce investments in the tactical radio systems. We are committed to developing and fielding the armored multi-purpose vehicle to replace our obsolete M113 family of vehicles and augmenting our wheeled fleet through the Joint Light Tactical family of vehicles, the JLTV. We also have the Paladin Integrated Management remaining a significant priority, and we will continue funding a 3rd Brigade set of double V-hull strikers while supporting incremental upgrades to existing double V-hull power and mobility. A new infantry fighting vehicle remains a key requirement for the Army. However, due to significant fiscal constraints, the Department will conclude the Ground Combat Vehicle Program upon completion of the technology demonstration phase, expected in June of 14. Instead, the Army now focuses its efforts on refining concepts, requirements, and key technologies in support of a future infantry fighting vehicle. This will include investment in vehicle components, subsystem prototypes, and technology demonstrators. In the distant future, we anticipate initiating a new combat vehicle program informed by these efforts as resources become available. The Army will also restructure aviation formations to achieve a leaner, more efficient, and capable force that balances operational capability and flexibility across the total Army. The Army National Guard will transfer all AH-64 Apache helicopters to the active Army, where they will be teamed with unmanned systems for armed reconnaissance and continued traditional attack role. The active Army will transfer 111 UH-60 Black Hawk helicopters to the Army National Guard, which will significantly improve its capabilities for support of civil authorities, homeland defense, and disaster response. The UH-72 Lakota will replace the TH-67 training helicopter fleet. We will divest almost 900 legacy helicopters, including the entire Kiowa Warrior and TH-67 training helicopter fleets. The active Army's overall helicopter fleet will decline by 23%, almost 700 helicopters, while the Army National Guard's fleet will decline by 8%. The resulting active and reserve component force mix will result in better and more capable formations, which are able to respond to contingencies at home and abroad. And in closing, we are adjusting to reduce to those resources that have been cut, which means we must accept greater risk in our Army modernization. The Army's ability to modernize equipment relies on sufficient, consistent funding. While the Bipartisan Budget Act of 2013 provided greater budget certainty for FY14 and 15, reductions in the modernization accounts continue to challenge the Army, and the forecast in the future beyond 15 is questionable. Without Congress intervention, sequestration level budget caps will return in FY16 and impose greater risk on Army equipment modernization, leaving our soldiers less prepared in an unpredictable world. Mr. Chairman, members of the subcommittee, again, thank you for your steadfast and generous support of our outstanding men and women of the United States Army and the Army civilians and their families. And we look forward to your questions today. Thank you.
General, thank you for your very clear statement. Those are very particular words that I think charge us. We're going to go to Mr. D and then come back to General Walters.
Chairman Turner, Ranking Member Sanchez, distinguished members of the subcommittee, thank you for the opportunity to appear before you today to address the Marine Corps Ground Force Modernization and the acquisition programs that support the future capabilities of our Marines. Lieutenant General Walters and I have submitted a joint statement for the record, so with your permission, I'll be very brief in my opening remarks. As you have pointed out, the fiscal environment resulting from the BCA, although mitigated somewhat in the near term by the Bipartisan Budget Act, has presented us with challenges as we plan for and execute the modernization of our ground force. Given the Marine Corps role as America's expeditionary force in readiness, we necessarily place a priority on current readiness and crisis response. Nevertheless, our capability development community and our programmers, led by General Walters, diligently strive to appropriately balance the varied Marine Corps capability portfolios within the available resources provided to them. Similarly, the Marine Corps acquisition community diligently endeavors to squeeze every dime out of every dollar and deliver the very best warfighting capabilities for the least cost. In the service with the smallest investment account, there is no alternative. And we're proud of what our acquisition Marines have accomplished this past year. Under program leadership of the Army, the Joint Light Tactical Vehicle Team was recognized by USD AT&L with the David Packard Excellence in Acquisition Award for its success at reducing both development and procurement costs while also reducing schedule. JLTV is on schedule to begin production in 2015. Our Gator ground-air task-oriented radar program successfully completed its developmental testing and is preparing for its first LRIP contract award with an IOC in fiscal year 17. We went into full production and began fleet delivery of the Enhanced Combat Helmet, which delivers the best performing protective capability per ounce of any helmet ever fielded. We completed an intensive and very deep technical and cost analysis of our ACV program, providing the Marine Corps leadership with the detailed and objective information that they needed to decide the future shape of the Marine Corps' top ground program priority. And in partnership with the Navy, our CH-53 Kilo is on schedule to record its first flight this year, and when it achieves IOC in fiscal year 19, it will triple the external lift capacity of the legacy CH-53 Echo. So although just a few examples of the efforts of the Navy and the Marine Corps Acquisition Force, often in partnership with the Army, they are representative of the diligence with which the Acquisition Force strives to achieve the very most with every dollar that the American taxpayer, as represented by this committee, entrusts to us. So thank you for this opportunity to appear today, and I look forward to your questions.
Thank you, General Walters.
Chairman Turner, Ranking Member Sanchez, distinguished members, it's my pleasure to speak to you today regarding the Marine Corps' modernization efforts. Throughout our 238-year history, the Marine Corps has answered our nation's call to be the most ready when the nation is least ready. Today, we operate freely throughout the world, responding to the wide spectrum of threats, doing so from the sea, oftentimes in austere environments. Our ability to deploy at a moment's notice is supported by our investment in modernized equipment. We see this not just buying new equipment, but as an investment in our Marines, our most important resource. When our Marines have the best, most modern equipment, they can meet every mission we give to them. Through the generosity of Congress, much of what the Marines deploy with today is the best and most modern equipment. Over the past decade of combat, the cost to equip a Marine has increased by almost six times. But we're providing Marines with better equipment and more of it. In 2000, the basic set of equipment we sent Marines who deployed included 14 items totaling about $2,400 in today's dollars. Today, Marines deploy with 45 items that cost about $13,700. We've given Marines more capability to operate, a radio set, an upgraded first aid kit, improved body armor, cold weather gear, and the list goes on and on.
We also recognize the importance of mobility through better performance and lighter weight for individual equipment. As we've better equipped our Marines over the past decade, we have become mindful to find the right balance between performance, weight, and affordability. We've worked hand in hand with the Army to find the best solution, leveraging each other's research and development efforts on individual protective equipment. We are currently working to field the enhanced combat helmet, the modular scalable protective system, and improved modular tactical vests. Even with a significantly modernized individual equipment set, many of our ground vehicles have been worn from over a decade of sustained conflict and have either been reset or will be reset over the next few years. Reset will provide a bridge until our major acquisition efforts begin to deliver significant quantities. As described in my prepared statement, our ground tactical vehicle portfolio will replace several aging platforms. Working with the Army, we continue to develop the Joint Light Tactical Vehicle, replacing the Humvee. We are also replacing our 40-year-old amphibious assault vehicles with the Amphibious Combat Vehicle, or ACV, the Marine Corps' top ground modernization priority. The program has been refined to reflect a family of systems approach that will permit amphibious operations rapidly from further offshore while enhancing protected mobility for the mission on land. We'll do this in a phased approach in concert with a revision of our concept of operations for littoral maneuver. The first phase will leverage work done on the earlier Marine personnel carrier program. We examined non-developmental wheeled combat vehicles that can provide several capabilities we desire: maneuverability, protection, and limited water mobility. In parallel with the development of the first phase, we will mitigate near-term risk in the high-end amphibious operations by fully funding survivability upgrades in a limited number of our AAVs. This will allow the AAV to serve as an effective bridge until it is replaced by the second phase of ACV. The effort will continue research and development to explore capabilities that will better enable us to conduct extended range littoral maneuver from ship to shore. As we've modified our ACV program, our necessity for lift by sea or by air for our ground vehicle portfolio remains constant. For our aviation programs, that means following through on our multi-year procurement of the MV-22 and continuing research and development of the CH-53K heavy lift replacement program. For fiscal year 15, we are requesting $1.53 billion to procure 19 MV-22s. For the entire multi-year procurement program, we will be purchasing 93 and saving approximately $1 billion when compared to single-year procurements. For the CH-53K, we're requesting $573 million that will continue EMD engineering and manufacturing development. The dollars will be used to continue development, test flights, deliver the final engineering development model aircraft, and start assembly of four systems demonstration test articles. All of these investments are critical to the Marine Corps' ability to maintain near-term readiness. However, full implementation of sequestration level caps outlined in the Budget Control Act will force us into a less ready force while also imposing severe restrictions on our modernization efforts. We are proud of our reputation of frugality and remain one of the best values for the defense dollar, but we will sacrifice our modernization in order to be the most ready Marine Corps for the nation. Thank you, and I look forward to your questions.
Thank you, General. General Williamson, again, congratulations on your upcoming third star. I have a relatively long question, but it is just one, and I will limit myself to one because there is a relatively long statement in setting up the question. But before I do, I certainly want to acknowledge and thank again General Barkley for your comments on the budgetary challenges. Your statement of during this period of fiscal and strategic uncertainty, the fiscal uncertainty is obviously something that we should be tackling. Strategic uncertainty, we'll never be able to determine what those who might threaten us do, but the issue of fiscal uncertainty is something that we're imposing upon ourselves, not just lower numbers, but the issue of uncertainty. And I appreciate your calling on Congress to give you that certainty and address the issue of sequestration in 2016. You should not be facing the either a cliff coming after 2015, making you cut a glide path through 2015, nor should you be facing the threat of what everyone has testified before this entire committee and subcommittee as being unacceptable levels of funding in which our military would not be able to function or and would significantly damage readiness. General Williamson, the question of uncertainty also falls upon our industrial base, because as your posture is uncertain, then it falls upon the industrial base for uncertainty, and that affects investment, that affects employees, people in their even their personal plans. But I'd like to take a moment to elaborate just a little bit more on one of the industrial base concerns that I have and that I raised during my opening statement. As you know, Congress has leaned forward on many critical national security issues that have included providing additional funding beyond what the Department of Defense has requested for current operations. We've done so in body armor, up-armored Humvees, mine-resistant ambush protective vehicles, or MRAPs, and critical ISR capabilities. All these come to mind in areas where Congress has leaned in and increased the funding above what the Department of Defense has requested that all came out to be critical capabilities. In many cases, the requirement process hadn't caught up and validated the need for this funding, but ultimately, these congressional actions proved to be invaluable in addressing the needs of the warfighter. It is in this context that the committee views previous initiatives directed at the industrial base for the Abrams tanks, Bradley fighting vehicles, and Stryker combat vehicles, as well as others. Take the Joint Systems Manufacturing Center, JSMC, at Lima as an example. Now, this is not in my congressional district, but it is in Ohio, and I do have familiarity with it. Last year, the Army testified that it was not their intent to close this facility. The Army indicated that the real issue was based on constrained resources, and they were going to rely on foreign military sales alone to keep the facility viable until the next major Abrams tank upgrade came along in 2019. Because of the uncertainty in foreign military sales, Congress took the position that foreign military sales alone was an unacceptable level of risk. So the Army and Congress were agreeing that the facility should not close, but Congress and the Army were in disagreement as to whether or not the foreign military sales alone would be sufficient to keep the facility open. To be fair, the Army has taken considerable strides in addressing some of the committee's concerns. For example, with this budget request, the Army has moved the next major series of upgrades to some of their major weapon systems called Engineering Change Proposals, or ECPs, from 2019 to 2017, which, by the way, is something that this committee recommended last year. I am still concerned about the timing of when some of the foreign military sales funding will be available, and we are taking a close look at that. But I'm glad to see that the Army is now taking positive actions in better managing this industrial base. Again, the industrial base cannot be flipped on and off like a switch. And if we disagree as to the uncertainty or uncertainty of foreign material sales, then the outcome could be incredibly detrimental to our industrial base. However, I'm still wondering if there aren't things that we can do or things that you could do with our help that are acquisition reform related, as opposed to just looking at the issue of is your number right or is our number right. For example, it is my understanding that when a foreign government wants to buy Abrams tanks using FMS funding, that they are required to pay a usage fee, which is sent directly to the U.S. Treasury. Now, I ask why these funds can't be kept at the facility with the production-based support funding line for facility maintenance, which then could be used for such things as critical safety and environmental deficiencies requirements. My understanding is that the department's position is that the government may not retain proceeds, either in the form of credits or cash, from the rental of government property. To allow the Army, in this case, to retain the process would be an improper augmentation of its funds and a violation of Title 31 U.S. Code Section 3320B, which I'm certain you're more familiar with than I am, which is also called the Miscellaneous Receipts Statute. I'm still in the process of gaining more information about this subject and how it crosses the committee's jurisdiction, but it seems to me interesting that if we're going to look to foreign military sales to support our industrial base, that it's odd that we should also look to foreign military sales as a revenue source that supports other areas of the government than our defense posture. So my question gets to this. During this limited resource environment, how can we find more efficient ways to utilize the commercial sector, the depots, and government-owned contractor-operated facilities, such as the Joint Systems Manufacturing Center, so we can try to avoid these spikes and peaks and don't continue to put these critical facilities at risks? And do you have thoughts as to what should we be doing in acquisition reform so we can get merely beyond the lever of on and off or the lever between your number and our number. General.
Mr. Chairman, thank you for the question. And so there's a couple of parts to the answer, but I want to start with one of the comments that you made, and that is this notion of risk. So when you start to have a conversation about the industrial base, you have to understand really where the risk lie. And what has to happen at this point is that we can't offer a solution that just relies on FMS, as you have stated. But I believe there has to be a three-prong attack on this. One, FMS provides us a lot of capability, and it's important in terms of adding that capacity, that work, into our industrial base. So it is an answer, and I would be the first to tell you, having dealt with FMS, foreign military sales, directly for the last year, and that not all FMS cases come through. And so I acknowledge that. And so that can't be the only plan. The second part, though, I would offer is there are some efficiencies that we probably need to look at. So when I talked about risk earlier, the thing that we have to identify is, where is the risk? Is that in the skill sets, critical skill sets? Is that in the tooling and the special machinery that's used in these facilities? Is it a combination of the two? And so what do we have to do? What's the minimum level that we have operating at any of these facilities? And then in terms of acquisition reform, one of the things we have to look at is there enough or is there too much specific statute, rules, police forces, where money can and cannot go, that adds to the overhead cost associated with running these facilities. The good news, sir, is that this committee has asked us to look at acquisition reform, and so we're doing some research in that area. And so when you take a look at not only the research that's been done by the Department of Defense in their sector by sector, tier by tier study, what we had a third party do in the early A.T. Kern results that help us to understand the industrial base. And then a third aspect where the AMC commander, the Army Material Commander, General Vi, and my boss, Ms. Hsu, have started to go to each facility to start to get detailed understanding of what are the cost drivers, what is causing the overhead cost, and where are there opportunities. I think as we work along all three of those fronts, leveraging FMS when it's available, we've done some things, as you've indicated, by ECPs, where we've been able to smooth those peaks and valleys so that we can assure some level of work and some capacity throughout these facilities. And then third, find opportunities where changes in some of our acquisition rules policy may allow us to reduce the overhead cost. I think these three things will help us in looking at not only the efficiency piece, but also the effectivity. And so the combination of those things are what I believe will allow us to maintain these national assets.
Thank you. I look forward to continuing this discussion, because I think both your insight and the financial circumstance we're in just require that we pursue these and actually find solutions that we can implement. So thank you for your expertise.
Yes, sir.
Turning to my ranking member, Loretta Sanchez.
Thank you, Chairman Turner. And again, thank you, gentlemen. This question is about body armor and the industrial base, because last year we tasked the Army with a review of the current body armor and soldier protection equipment and the industrial base, and the outlook for future development and procurement, production and procurement. And the committee asked for this analysis based on the end of a large scale, two wars, land wars, outfitting everybody, et cetera. And now we're looking at bringing back some of the end strength, bringing down some of the end strength, et cetera. And body armor and what it's going to look like and how we're going to procure it. The briefing that was provided to Congress painted a mixed picture. On one hand, it showed that the Army has a solid plan to invest about $178 million in research and development over the next 5 years, and that it's also starting a new program, the Soldier Protection System, to integrate new protective equipment. However, the briefing also pointed out that there's probably not enough funding in the budget for procurement of the new body armor to keep the two current domestic producers or vendors that we have producing this. So my question is, how much additional funding would we need, in your opinion, in this fiscal year 2015 to keep both of these vendors in production? And in your opinion, is it good to have that competition going or have these two vendors going? And if we went down to just one vendor, will that make it more difficult in the future if we have to ramp up in the way that we needed to do for Iraq and Afghanistan?
Ma'am, so I'd like to start by saying the answer for me is the competition is always better. And so maintaining an industrial base that provides us with choice is obviously going to help us to get a better price. The challenge that I have in this case is really tied to the item. And so you have to look at this kind of from two lenses. The first lens is from an RDT&E look. So our drive is, how do you improve the protection level of that equipment? And at the same time, how do we drive the cost down and the weight down? So if you look from 2007 to 2014, there's been this significant drop in weight and increase in protection. And what's allowed us to do that is the investment in the research and development and the ability for people, organizations, companies, vendors to manufacture. And so we have to have both of those capabilities. But the first question that I ask to the folks who do the work here is, I don't understand. Tell me what happens when you store, for instance, that body armor. And so how quickly do you see deterioration? How fast do we have to recycle and replace? So obviously there are those things that are damaged, lost, that you have to do a replacement. But is there some life expectancy for this material that affects its protection capability? And so understanding all of those pieces of the set that we have today, the set that we're going to need in the future, and the ability for industry to manufacture that, helps us to shape our engagement with the vendor community. And so I think my short answer is that obviously I would like to maintain that competition. The challenge, as you indicated though, is the funding level associated with the procurement of additional sets and our ability to use those. We've asked the PEO to conduct that study. They are starting to get some of the feedback from that, and I would be happy to bring that information into you as we get smarter on what the industrial base looks like and the capacity that's required as we deal with the risk that we know today and expected risk.
General, before we worked on this body armor issue here on the committee, we had the body armor issue of just our regular law enforcement folks, our police departments and sheriffs, et cetera. And one of the things, you know, with respect to body armor, of course, is what kind of wear and tear does it take? In that case, we knew that after 5 years, because of sweat and conditions and everything, in fact, we passed a grant program that gave federal funds to the police departments to actually procure body armor for their officers. So I think there's a lot of, and what they had is what we kind of started with in the military, but we've evolved so much, as you know, over the last 10 years with wraparound and lighter. And I think it's definitely something that we need to continue to work. And in the time that I've been on this committee looking at this issue, I certainly have seen several companies go out of business and drop off because they could not really compete with respect to the weight and the deterrent factor and the wraparound and everything. So I think we have at least two really, really good companies now who I think will continue to try to outperform each other. And I do believe that that's better for us. But how we keep them alive during this time where we really don't know if we'll procure or not. So I go back to that question of how much do you think in this budget that we're talking about would we need to take a look at or put in to ensure that at least these two companies stay on their feet to duke it out for a while? Do you have any estimate at all, or and how long will that study that you're anticipating take before we'll know?
Ma'am, at this point, I don't have a good number in terms of what it would take to, for the industrial base to keep two companies going. And so what I would ask is that I be given the opportunity to come back and give you some details on what we're finding. And if I could, I would also just add that your comment about the police force and other organizations that used VEST, that's the other aspect that we have to include is how do we capitalize that we're not the only organization that is procuring these. So in addition to the other services, when you start to look at police forces and security forces, is there a way to leverage them in terms of us using the industry to help us drive down cost and in addition, keep the industrial base going? And if possible, I'd like to come back and provide that information.
I'll look forward to your ideas on that. Thank you.
Thank you, ma'am.
General, and thank you, Mr. Chairman, for the time.
Thank you, Mr. Bredenstein.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. The Army's artillery schoolhouse is in my state at Fort Sill. And I was wondering if you could comment, General Barclay and General Williamson, if you could comment on the Army's commitment to the Paladin Integrated Management System and, of course, modernization in general of artillery systems in the Army.
So I'll take the first part, and then I'll let Michael finish up with it. But I will tell you that the PIM, and as you noticed, it was in my opening statement. It's also in my written statement about the importance of that program to the
Army. I did notice. Thank you.
That ought to tell you that that is one of our critical programs, along with the JLTV and AMVI, that we know that we have got to continue moving ahead on that. It's very critical to the operational impact, but also as we look down the road of how we integrate across the different components of the Army. So from an operational perspective and equipment modernization, the PIM is one of our critical programs that we're continuing to push in the future.
So, sir, I have to start by saying as an air defense artillery officer, I also know that the school has moved up to Oklahoma. And here's where I would start, and that is the PIM program is critically important for us. As you can see in the budget, we've invested substantial dollars in not only supporting that program from an RDT&E position, but what you really see in there is that we are starting to produce those PIMs, and you'll see 66 of those coming off the line. And so I'm impressed with the program. It's one of the programs that I would admit had a rocky start, but I would tell you now that it's performing very well.
General, do you think it would be appropriate to do multi-year procurement of PIM for the purposes of getting it to the field sooner and at a lesser cost per unit?
So again, I think both of us will comment. I mean, but from a programming perspective, we've had great success in multi-year programs, and your support from Congress in allowing us to do that has allowed us to save a great bit of dollars. So far, most of those programs, as you know, have been in the aviation arena on the multi-year. But in this era we're in with fiscal uncertainty and reduced dollars, anything we can do, and if the multi-years allow us to continue modernization at the levels we know we need to, then that's we will look at that every opportunity we get.
Sir, the only thing I would add is purely as an acquisition view, is that multi-year gives me a lot of leverage in a negotiation. And so, as you know, there are some rules that are applied that we don't do multi-years unless it returns a significant savings. And so the opportunities to use those, we fully support. But again, what I would offer is that the challenge we have is understanding the funding that would be available and to be able to steady state that. But just like the question on competition, so multiple vendors are a good thing. Multi-year in the right negotiation is also a very good thing.
Roger that, gentlemen. I yield back, Mr. Chairman.
Thank you, Ms. Duckworth.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. General Williamson, again, congratulations on your third star. I want to talk to you a little bit about the procurement process, especially through the use of NAGRIA funding. Can you tell me whether or not there's been a review of the validity of the plan that General Barclay put forward to transition, to move equipment such as the the 72s and the Apaches from the Guard to the active duty when those systems were either upgraded with NAGRIA funds or purchased, as in 2008, for the 72s with NAGRIA funds?
Ma'am, I'll address and then I'll let Michael do it. But first of all, we are taking or moving no LUHs out of the National Guard. Under this Aviation Restructure Initiative, all of the LUHs, 72s, that the National Guard has remain in the National Guard. So all those special mission aircraft that they have added some special mission equipment on, mm-hmm. using NAGRIA-type funds to do that, will remain within the Guard,
okay.
The program. So all the LUHs that are going to move into the training are coming out of the active component, and then we're going to procure some more LUHs to finish out, round out that number that is needed for that. So we're not moving any of that. And then the Apaches, as you know, there are no NAGRIA funds that go. Those are all straight Army funds as we program those systems.
As you move the... I have neither Apaches nor LUHs in my state, so no dog in that hunt for me. As you move the Apaches out of the combat aviation brigades, you're fundamentally changing the nature of those brigades so that they're no longer similar to active duty ones, which then means that you've now taken the attack part of the attack capacity away from the National Guard's divisions. So now you've fundamentally affected the composition of what a division is in the National Guard. Can you talk a little bit about the decision to go that route, and is that something that obviously is acceptable? Because now it's not just about the Apaches, it's about the composition of an entire division.
Yes, ma'am, we looked very hard at that in doing our analysis, and there will be active Apaches aligned with the National Guard divisions and those combat aviation brigades. You and I, as Black Hawk pilots, will tell you that Apaches are not the only combat aircraft.
I've seen the videos of them hanging the missiles on Black Hawks, and had my fantasies, yes, too, General.
Yes, it's not just hanging missiles on them. It's the combat mission roles they do in those assaults and stuff. So by
not
moving those Apaches out, you know, it doesn't mean that we will not keep them aligned. And there will be, again, a multi-compo, but again, it will be active Apaches aligned to the National Guard divisions. And we are not changing the name. Those brigades in the Guard continue to be combat aviation brigades because they have Chinooks that do combat missions, Blackhawks that do combat missions. They have Medevac, and we all know that Medevac go in some of the most, you know, strenuous missions that we have on the battlefield. So, but yes, ma'am, we did look at that. But again, it's based on the physical constraints we had to meet the overall operational demands of the total Army, to best case where we could turn to meet those demands. And so with the design that we have presented, we think we've met that.
But I mean, ultimately, you're still taking the attack capacity away from those aviation brigades. I mean, it's aerosol pilots, we like to think we're as big a stud and as bad as the Apache guys. They may disagree with us. But you are, when you take the Apaches out, you've taken away the guns, that capacity. So it does fundamentally change, and I think we need to be clear that that's what's happening. I'm going to, with my remaining time, talk to General Walters just very briefly. If you could, General Amos was up here a couple weeks ago and spoke about the Marine Corps' ground vehicle strategy, and he gave a very nuanced description that I thought was well thought out. And you know, my understanding is that it's a mix of acquiring the JLTV and maintaining and recapitalizing of the MRAPs and the up-arm Humvees until full acquisition of the JLTV is completed, at which point the Humvees, I think, will be phased out. You know, I know that the JLTV is your long-term solution, and obviously you're trying to bridge that gap with with the Humvees and the MRAPs in the meantime, but I am concerned about a potential capabilities gap, especially with a legacy system like the Humvees. Could you update us on the Humvee sustainment and modernization efforts, and is it being sufficiently resourced in order to fill that gap in the meantime? You know, I'm just basically concerned that you're trying to balance a number of different programs simultaneously, as you're trying to work towards a JLTV?
No, ma'am. Thanks for the question. And you're right. We are trying to balance three different legs on the same stool. We are partnering with the Army on the JLTV. That's not going to deliver for a while. We have about 24,000 Humvees in our inventory right now in varying conditions. As we draw down, as we reduce our force, we've done the analysis to date that says we're going to need about, in light vehicles, we'll need about 17,000. I know these numbers don't wow the Army, but they're big for us. We'll need about 17,000 of these things. So we're in for about 5,500 JLTV. We're in for a Humvee SMI to put back the capability on the up-armored Humvee that it used to have when it wasn't armored. We got about 6,800 of those. So you add those two together, and that's about 12,000. If you'll accept my Marine math for a moment, that's about 12,000. So we need about another 5,000 vehicles to get that 17,000. And those are going to be the legacy platforms that we'll hold around, and those will be the first ones that roll off. All of this is colored by our requirement to come in in September of this year with a new ground combat vehicle strategy. So that's the analysis is going on right now. The numbers I just gave you are our current position. So as we go through this and we see that there could be decisions made, and if I think you're alluding to is, shouldn't we be buying more JLTVs and less of these or more? Absolutely, that will be an option. And then the requirements folks will come in, we'll get the strategy done, and then we'll see if we can fiscally afford it. Thank you.
Thank you. I yield back, Mr. Chairman.
Thank you. General Barkley, I had the opportunity in December to travel to Fort Rucker, Alabama, with Congresswoman Roby. And we certainly recognize you as the senior aviator in the Army, and we know you're very familiar with the Army's aviation's needs and Fort Rucker and, of course, the restructuring initiative. So for the record, let me just go down part of what you had said in your opening statement about the aviation restructure initiative. It includes a divestiture of the OH-58D Kiowa Warrior helicopters and TH-67 helicopters, consolidation of all AH-64 Apache helicopters into the active component, as Ms. Duckworth was saying, as well as providing additional UH-60 Blackhawks to the National Guard and additional LUH-72 Lakotas, the active component. The Army's and Office of the Secretary of Defense assessment is that by reducing from 7 types of rotorcraft to 3 and divesting the oldest platforms while preserving the most capable, survivable, and modern aircraft, the Army can retain its ability to meet warfighting demands and any Title 32 domestic emergency response requirements from state governments. As currently proposed, as you indicated in your statement, the ARI reduces the acting component rotary wing by 32% and the National Guard fleet by 8%. So, General, my question to you is this eliminating excess capacity or actual capability?
Sir, I will tell you that we really didn't have excess capacity, but what we could not afford was to sustain 7 different models. We had an aging training fleet. We had an aging Kiowa Warrior fleet for the armed reconnaissance mission that we had tried to replace that did not produce any vendors that could meet those requirements. So based on the physical constraints we were under, the only thing we could do was to consolidate and then take this initiative to streamline, take out older airframes, and get us down to those that we can afford within the physical constraints that we're under and still meet the mission set. So I think as we looked across the board and did the analysis, both with Fort Rucker, and we also had the National Guard in as we were doing the analysis to look at the numbers, the options that we came up with, this was the best case that we could do within the dollar amount that we were given.
Thank you for the clarity of that. General Walters, could you give us an answer with respect to the Marine Corps and what decisions they're making in rotorcraft programs that we might need to have highlighted?
Yes, sir. Thanks. I mentioned the V-22 multi-year. It's very, very hot on our mind that we need to maintain that. I worry about that because if we get sequestered, you know, the mechanical nature of that, bust that, and then instead of, for example, we're asking for 19 in fiscal year 15, part of a multi-year. If we were sequestered in 15, I know we're facing that in 16, but if we were sequestered in 15, you know, we would
Hopefully you're not facing that in 16.
Yes, sir.
It's currently on the books, but hopefully you're not facing that.
It's an old axiom in the military, sir. You plan for the worst and hope for the best. I think it's an exemplar of what worries us about our rotary wing aircraft programs. We asked for 19. If we somehow got sequestered, thank God we didn't. Thank you very much for doing that in 15. But if we did get sequestered in 15, then I wouldn't have enough. We'd bust the multi-year, one. And instead of the dollars we're putting in there buying 19 of those aircraft, we have to go to single-year procurement, and for the same number of dollars, I could only probably buy 17. So I'm losing two. You do that across a five-year, so I've lost two squadrons worth of aircraft over a five-year period. We are very concerned, we're not very concerned. We are watching very closely our 53-kilo program. That is the key to our future. That thing is going to lift everything we need to off the ships, and we're trying to keep our H-1 program on track. So those are our three biggies, sir, the V-22, 53K, and the H-1.
Thank you. General Williamson, the Army continues to declare that fielding of the network is your highest priority when it comes to modernization. Yet the FY15 request for two major network programs is lower than prior years. These programs are WINT and HMS radios, and it would seem to me that lower funding means less systems being fielded to the warfighters. Can you please elaborate this, and how long would it take the Army to field this network across the Army?
Sir, both of those programs obviously are critical to the Army, and the challenge that we have is when you start to look at that, the cost associated with both, it is an area where we've taken some risk, but not, I think, excessive risk. So the intent is, with those lower numbers that will go out, we will hit the most critical units as quickly as possible. We have reduced some of the capability. So as General Barkley indicated, some of the things that we would have done in WIN-T Increment 3, which enhanced not only some of the bandwidth capability, but the levels and the mobility associated with that, we have accepted some of that risk and combined some of that capability into the current increment. On the HMS Manpack, the HMS programs, whether it's the vehicle radios or the man portable radios, it will affect the density, if you will, of how many of those we get out to units. And so I'm not going to sit here and tell you that it doesn't come with some risk, but we do believe that the approach that we've taken gets the capability out to the Army, if not the entire Army, faster. General Barkley.
Well, sir, I think, in my opening statements, we are still committed to the network. But the lack of funding has caused us to delay these out. And so if you look at the far end, I guess if you look at the HMS radio, handheld radio, I mean, we're looking, you're probably going to be out to 2026. I mean, so that has pushed that way out. So all of those, as you said in your opening statement, everything is being moved, to the right, and it's because of the fiscal constraints we're under. But we are not backing away from our commitment to the network and its overall importance, as the Chief and the Secretary have testified. The soldier and the squad are the centerpiece of all of our modernization, and the network around them is what will make them powerful and be able to meet those mission sets. So that's why we are committed to it. It's just the timeline based on funding.
Comes the end of our questions. I do want to ask if anyone has any closing remarks or any additional remarks that they'd like to make for the record. Seeing none, then this hearing will be closed. Thank you, gentlemen.